What do you call a collection of cats? What are those called? A litter?
No. Oh, a litter is like what
the thing
is
they
born.
Shit in?
It's
a group of assholes.
It's something. It's like a clower.
Ha!
A Jerry Clower.
Ha!
I don't remember what he sounds like. Otherwise, I would. I'm just getting like foghorn leghorn is what I.
Ha!
A clowder.
A clowder.
Clowder. So the cats here in this apartment are the Crowder Clowder.
That is actually neat. That's a neat thing.
Everybody, welcome back to Book Club. I am your host and conch holder this week, Dylan.
I'm Ansel.
And I'm Elijah Crowder.
And the book for this week is The Many-Headed Hydra, Sailors, Slaves, Commoners, and the Hidden History of the Revolutionary Atlantic, written by Peter Linebaugh and Marcus Rediker. And here is the Goodreads synopsis. It's real brief. Using a decade of original research into the 17th and 18th century, this text unearths ideas and stories about liberty, democracy, and freedom that terrified the ruling classes of the time and formed the foundations of modern revolutions. And that's a pretty good summation of the book, I think. To the extent to which I read it, I did not finish this book. It can be at times very dry, historical. It's a nonfiction book, obviously, and it's kind of it is a very dry. I felt myself kind of yearning for the Indifferent Stars Above, that kind of style where it kind of took the history and it presented a narrative with it.
Yeah,
but I could see how it would be much harder to do with this information, and they were obviously setting out to get this research that they had done out and present it, and they definitely had their perspective that they wanted to put out there, and they weren't necessarily interested in telling a narrative, which made it a difficult read for me. But what did y'all think? Give me some first impressions of this book.
Go ahead, Ansel.
Well, I'm very ashamed to say that I did not get much of this book read. I tried, and every time I tried, I just fell asleep. This is just it's just not for me. Like, honestly, like I never was into history at all, and you know, I don't like that about myself. I wish I was like all about that history, but I can't. You know, it just doesn't register. I can't retain it, and this book, I literally just kept falling asleep every time I read this book. I could wait, you know. First thing this morning, I woke up. I was like, "Let's get a good bit of this book read." Started reading it, just fell right back asleep. History's not for me. I was looking for, like, usually it's when I would read history anything. It was like in school, and you were getting the answer out of the paragraphs to put in the blank. So it's like I feel like I was committing things to memory that. Like out of habit. So yeah. I know like The Tempest was first shown in like 1611 or something like that. But not my cup of tea.
I kind of want to do contradictory statements here. I want to echo some of what Ansel said, but at the same time I want to not so much file a grievance, but go ahead and say that I don't think one episode of Book Club is enough to touch the first half of this book as far as the denseness. Denseness is not a word. The density.
Viscosity.
The viscosity. The sibilance. the sheer amount of information and stories that are presented, and it's very telling that you say you fall asleep, because I do dig the history, and I think it's such an overload of information, in, especially in the first two or three chapters, where it is fascinating stuff. That's the contradictory statement. It is fascinating stuff, but it's also stuff that is very, in a way, common sense when you think about the times and the people that are being spoken about. And it's also, it's straight from the racks of academia, man. These guys did their research. This is not a novel. This is something that you would have to read and go back and read. And I found myself also not finishing the book because I would get into something and then go off on a tangent and start researching the black dog of Newgate Prison, or, you know, all these interesting things that they throw out. So that's going to affect this podcast episode heavily.
So I should probably say, for my part, the reason I didn't finish it is because I'm not all that smart, and I have no business doing a book podcast about reading books. But anyway, I'm not trying to fool anybody. Like, this is above my head.
Yeah.
Well, and before we be here today,
before we jump into it, right in the beginning, I mean, the introduction in the first three chapters are basically spent showing why they titled the book "The Many-Headed Hydra."
Yeah.
Agree or disagree? Agree.
I mean, it was there. Yeah, they talked about the Hydra a lot.
A lot, and the idea is that globalism is Hercules, and the Many-Headed Hydra are the trampled upon your everyday common laborers, your slaves, and the proletariat. I'm just going to come right out and say it. This is one of the most Marxist leftist pieces of literature I've read since I read Das Kapital, and they approach it objectively throughout the entire work, but just by its very nature,
This is the most Marxist thing I've read since Marx.
Since Marx, yeah. This is the most Marxist thing I've read since Marx.
That's about as Marxist as you can get.
Yeah.
I have a quote. "This book has had an impact in South Africa among both researchers and activists." This is from the introduction, by the way. "Among both researchers and activists, and in India, where a pirated edition circulated through Jawaharlal Nehru University in Delhi."
That's good praxis.
Yeah. Very good. Very good. All right. Back to you, Dylan. I wanted to get a lot in on the onset.
Yeah, well, about the Hydra, like, I thought it was a story in mythology that had kind of, like, captured the imaginations of people in the 17th century. Because everybody seemed to refer to it. Your Francis Bacon, your William Shakespeare. It was something like, it's kind of like the Joker now or something like that.
If they
had Twitter back then, everybody would have had, like, Hydra avatars and stuff.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I did dig up a little bit on, because it mentions in here the history of Bacon in Virginia, and that was a much drier read than I thought it was going to be. No, yeah. nothing there.
Is
that's
that
not
joke?
A joke. it was supposed to be. Let me try that again. Yeah. I did go ahead and look into the history of bacon in Virginia, and there was nothing in there about maple or pepper or apple smoke. It was
Oh, guys, I don't know if I can do it anymore.
Was it that bad?
I mean, it's not a good joke, but.
Hey, man, look at the material I had to work with, okay?
Yeah, just that's
all. Let me take another stab at that. All right. So, like, later in the book, it mentions a work called "The History of Bacon in Virginia." That was not very interesting.
I agree. It's kind of dry. Yeah. All right, so moving on. I'm going to just hit some highlights. So the in the preface, they're kind of like establishing what this book is, and it brings up this idea of history from below. And that's, it's just kind of saying that that's the perspective that this history is given. It's kind of like, you know, they always say that history is written by the victors. But no, this takes the perspective of the working class, the slaves, the pirates, the subjugated peoples. And yeah, it tells their stories at this time, which is actually like a really interesting time, because like this is the birth of global capitalism, and the world as we know it, this was its origin.
Yeah, I think they refer to it more as Atlantic capitalism.
Right.
More focused on what the English trading and maritime companies.
Did you say global capital? Is that what you described it as?
Yeah.
It does go global. Fifth, sixth chapter, it's more focused on global.
So, yeah, that's just keep that in mind as we're talking about this. This is history from the perspective of, like, the most oppressed people at this time. So the first chapter is about, it's called The Wreck of the Sea Venture, which is about a colony ship that was headed towards Jamestown, Virginia, to kind of restock their numbers with people and get some fresh blood in there, because, like, people were starving and dying and were having a horrible time in colonial Virginia. And they run into a storm and they get marooned in Bermuda. And Bermuda was not settled at this point. It was kind of like an island paradise, essentially. And yeah, these people that were headed towards Virginia, they're like, some of them were just like, no, we're good. We're good here living this beach life. Like, it talks about how plentiful, like, there was wild boars, like wild game, plenty of fruits and stuff, like fresh water. Like, they could have lived there. And I've actually got several highlights, but do y'all have anything to say in general about that chapter? Ansel, did you get that far?
Yeah, I know, I read that much, and I don't really have anything to add. I think that's the correct... I mean, they were going to Virginia anyway as... indentured servants anyway, right?
Yeah.
So
yes, for the most part.
And so,
well, yeah. I think that's one of the central themes of that chapter, is that it's one of the earliest forms of subject revolution against ownership, or the ownership hierarchy that was, I think, what did they call it later chapters? The hydrarchy of the sea.
Where they
basically, like, they came to round them up and they said, you know what, people are starving to death in Virginia, so fuck off, we're good.
Seriously. Yeah, yeah. I mean, that mutiny would have made sense anywhere, pretty much, knowing that, they knew what they had in store for them, but it especially made sense on, literal paradise.
Yeah. Well, I've actually got a bit highlighted here. I'll just read this out to you. It says here, the chief complaint of the seamen and the other hands was that in Virginia, nothing but wretchedness and labor must be expected, with many wants and a churlish entreaty, i.e. poor provision, there being neither that fish, flesh, nor fowl which here, at ease and pleasure, might be enjoyed. They somehow knew whereof they spoke, for colonists in Virginia were at that moment eating leather boots and serpents, looking like, quote-unquote, anatomies or skeletons, crying out, we are starved, we are starved. One man killed his wife, chopped her up, and salted her for food. Others dug up corpses from graves and ate them. So that's what was going on in Jamestown, Virginia. And yeah, the captain, like the bosses on the boat, were like, yeah, let's get this boat fixed and head on to Virginia.
Yeah.
And also, just a little taste of cannibalism in there. I felt like I kind of had to throw that in.
That is your brand.
That is, it's very on brand.
Yeah, there was a lot of that in here. Not so much bacon.
No. Well, there is a lot of talk about bacon, and like Francis Bacon, Like, I'd always heard that name, like, in history classes. I never retained exactly what he did. But just from reading this book, like, dude was kind of an asshole.
He's a bastard, yeah.
Like an evil, evil dude.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can't think of anything in particular, but it just seems like whenever something bad was happening involving the Virginia colony or any of, like, this expansion of the British Empire, like, he kept coming up and he kept doing, like, the wrong thing.
Yeah, he was the Ben Shapiro of his day. Wouldn't you say?
Well, I think he was probably, like, 5'2", so he's, like, way too tall to be the Ben Shapiro of his day. But, yeah, the wreck of the Sea Venture was really interesting because, like, these sailors and these people that were destined for... Oh, shit, my notes went away. Apologies. Like, they pretty much said no, and, yeah, the bosses and the bootlickers brought out the corporal punishment to get them back in line, and, yeah, it just kind of goes to show that capital will do whatever it has to do to make the capital move.
Yeah, I mean, that was, you know, that island paradise was sort of destroyed by, by the ownership class. HMS listener, by the way, we are not, Dylan, I can only speak for me and Dylan, like, we are not down with the sickness, and by the sickness, I mean capitalism. Elijah, I don't know about you, but I feel like we're kind of on the same page.
In as much as one can be. That's a hard row to hoe, so to say, because in human nature, you're always going to have a system of supply and demand. You're always going to have, and even if you're on a barter system, you're always going to have an economical reason that some things are more highly valued than others, some skills or some trade or some materials. But that being said, what we have and what we have in this book as well, going all the way back to the 14th century, is rampant and uncontrolled, unchecked capitalism. And that is the most disgusting thing man has ever brought to the table on the face of this earth.
Hear, hear.
So anyway, Just to put that out there, like, and I'm sure, like, I'm guessing you've came across that book on one of your
Viva la Revolución.
On one of your Reddit, on one of your Marxist subreddits or whatever.
Look, I'm not gonna out my fellow comrades. But no, I did hear about this book on a leftist subreddit.
Dylan. I've got a little snippet here before you go on. This is we were discussing Bacon, and we are also now discussing Marxism. This is one of the most Marxist things that was in came in the second chapter. If I can jump ahead, under the curse of labor, and it mentions Bacon. We argue that the many expropriations of the day of the commons, by enclosure and conquest of time, by the puritanical abolition of holidays, of the body by child stealing and the burning of women, and of knowledge by the destruction of guilds and assaults on paganism, gave rise to new kinds of workers, to a new kind of slavery, enforced directly by terror. We also suggest that the emergence of cooperations among workers, in new ways and on a new scale, facilitated new forms of self-organization among them, which was alarming to the ruling class of the day. Bacon saw the new combinations of workers and monsters as monstrous and used the myth of the many-headed Hydra to develop his theory of monstrosity, a subtle, thinly veiled policy of terror and genocide. The idiom of monstrosity would gain special relevance with the emergence of a revolutionary movement in England in the 1640s, in which the proletarian forces opposed by Bacon would play a critical part. That paragraph in chapter 2 basically sums up chapters 1, 2, 3, 4. everything that he's mentioned there, they go into great detail in. But it's, I mean, that's it. That's what a rising objective way to say Viva la Revolucion. Look at what Bacon did, that bastard.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, like Shakespeare kept popping up. Like it seemed like he was like a you know, stakeholder in all this too.
Right.
Somehow.
No, he was he had bought stock in the Virginia company that founded the Jamestown settlement.
Which kind of threw me, because I thought, like, you know, they didn't even know if Shakespeare had existed or not. Like, but I guess that's kind of conspiratorial.
Yeah.
Conspiratorial, I don't know the word, but
well, I think the thing is that maybe, like, he wasn't necessarily the person that was writing the books. I've heard apparently some people believe that, like, a queen at the time was writing the stories, but yeah,
or it was like I've heard like it was William Wordsworth. Like if you do like a analysis of the vocabulary and the flow and the statistics of it.
Yeah.
The only thing I remember of Shakespeare from my days in college was that he was always writing about his penis. So I don't really remember much of what Shakespeare wrote. It's just all about, it's all phallic imagery. That's all he wrote about was dick jokes.
I mean, I see what you're saying. Like, yeah, they people have like an absolute interpretation of Shakespeare, and like, it's like we talked about with Michael Indy, and Neverending Story. He had that quote. Well, it's not really, you know, it doesn't work like that. It's just like something that exists. I don't know. I don't know what I'm saying.
Cool. we moving forward here. We got the so just something a note that I really like to read to y'all. This is basically just some anarcho-primitivist pornography, basically.
All right.
This is it's talking about the Algonquin Indians.
Oh yeah, I remember that.
That were, I'm guessing they were like neighbors to the Jamestown settlers. But yeah, let me just read this to you. The 14,000 allied Algonquins inhabited a rich ecological zone made up of mixed forest and Chesapeake waterways, on which they exercised an economy of collecting and horticulture. They hunted Virginia white-tailed deer, bear, wild turkey, goose, quail, duck. They fished herring, shad, sturgeon. They captured eels and shellfish, crabs, clams, oysters, mussels. They gathered fruits, berries, nuts, and they practiced tillage, maize, beans, and squash. They were nourished upon a better all-around diet than the Europeans. The Confederation consisted of small-scale societies without ownership of land, without classes, without a state, but with all paying tribute to, and I'm going to butcher this name, Wahunsonacock, the subtle old fox. They pursued little economic specialization and attempted little trade. They were self-sufficient. Their society was organized around matrilineal descent, and both men and women enjoyed sexual freedom outside marriage. There existed no political military bureaucracy for their roughly 1,500 warriors. Even Wahunsonacock performed the task of an ordinary man and was dressed by all, not by his title, but by his personal name. That's like one of the most idyllic descriptions of an existence I've ever heard, and that just kind of spoke to my soul.
No one could screw that up more than the European white man.
Right. And like, yeah, capitalism is why that doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Ownership society and rampant unchecked capitalism. Mic drop moment. Thank you. Good night.
Yeah, I too read that and I was like,
are you still awake, Ansel?
I'm having a hard time over here. Sorry, it's just it's not you guys. It's nothing personal. It's just
I thought about this while reading the book as well. I was like, you know, this isn't going to lend itself so much to a comedy podcast. But, I mean, we're not always funny. And, I mean, I think
God,
we're not.
The truth.
The bacon joke was great. Fuck you. Now, but, I mean, like, we do occasionally hint on very, very important motifs that on, I mean, we're reading a lot of stuff, and it's not always going to be hilarious stuff. There's not much to laugh about in this at all. But I don't think we have to look at it that way. If we can have a decent discussion on what's in this book, and I think Dylan's going to have to carry it for the last two or three chapters, because...
Oh, no, I only got about two-thirds of the way through it. Like,
okay.
Like, let me be clear. This this book does not lend itself to page-turning.
No.
I was fascinated with the... Like the stories, but it like I said at the top, it's really dry, and it will put you to sleep. You got to take it in doses, and yeah.
And another layer for me is that I don't have a humanities type like brain.
You don't,
you know what I mean? It's like I'm not really qualified to talk about this because I don't really know shit. Yeah, I mean, I was a math major for a reason, right?
But you don't think it's fascinating, like in the 1550s in London, they didn't refer to jails as prisons; they called them strong houses of sorrow.
Yeah, and that's
that kind of stuff.
But like, I have no context for it outside of this book. You see what I'm saying? It's like I don't really remember how it was presented to me before, and
sure
I don't remember what the
do.
Prevailing
sure you
wisdom
do.
Is.
Sure,
just,
you do. You've watched Monty Python. You've
Well,
you've been a member through cultural osmosis itself. That's something I started to take away from this, that a lot of this is detailed lookings into things that everyone should already know or suspect.
But specifically our American public education system, we specifically do not get this history from below.
No, you don't.
We do
you
not
don't.
Get this perspective. On
No, you
on
absolutely
these events.
Do not. I don't think I was hit with it until I was maybe 19 or 20 years old and got a copy of Howard Zinn's People's History of the U.S., and that was eye-opening for me for just how much is left out of the education system.
Did I get that for you as a Christmas gift?
I think you did.
Yeah, I did.
I'm pretty sure you did.
Yeah.
And it was amazing. It's still one of my favorite books, as much as people lambast it now for being maybe not 100% factual or...
Well, see, I haven't heard that. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean,
there are those out there who claim that it's garbage, but I mean, even if you take the stories in it at face value, or you don't, it's still amazing. It's amazing history that is completely omitted in school.
Cool. Moving on, unless there's any sort of rebuttal or anything there. Nope. All right. Taking it forward. Elijah, you said this book doesn't really lend itself to comedy very well, but let me read you this next passage. This one will get some chuckles, I think.
Okay, and then I get one after that to bring the chuckles away.
Okay.
All right.
During the 1690s, English sailors served under all colors for, according to John Ehrman, and again, now this is in Chapter 5 under Hydrarchy, Sailors, Pirates, and the Maritime... Something, something, something.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So during the 1690s, English sailors served under all colors for, according to John Ehrman, and I quote, "The interchange of seamen between the different maritime countries was too widespread to eliminate." So, yeah.
Read that last sentence for me one more time. I was falling asleep there for a second.
Well, yeah, now this is quoting John Ehrman. This is not me saying this. This is
okay.
What he said back in the 1690s. The interchange of seamen between the different maritime countries was too widespread to eliminate. The ship was thus not only the means of communication between continents, but also the first place where working people from those different continents, and my note cuts off there.
Yeah,
John Ehrman, go on book club.
The workers. Very good. I want to bring it back to chapter two for a second. Chapter two is titled, hold on, let me find the title, Hewers of Wood and Drawers of Water.
That's correct.
And chapter two goes into many, many alliterations on the biblical proponents of capitalism in the 1400s, 1500s. But I found this. I didn't know this. Women were a specific target of terror, as 4,000 witches were burned and hundreds more hanged after 1604, when the punishment for bewitchment was made more severe. The terror had three peaks. I did not know this. 1590 to 97, 1640 to 44, and 1660 to 63. Between 1558 and 1680, 5% of all English indictments and fully 13% in the home circuit contained charges of witchcraft. James I had himself interrogated women accused of witchcraft and had written a treatise of erudite misogyny, demonology, to assert against skeptics the reality of witchcraft and the need for capital punishment. It's interesting that that this coincides with the enclosures, the closing off of common lands for people to use, which... As an aside, there's also a striking resemblance to America in the Midwest and the invention of barbed wire in the Western before they were states, and how that transformed America into a capitalist hell. That this coincides with that same time, not just with that, but it goes on and says simultaneously with the enclosures, the beginning of the slave trade, and the enactment of laws against the vagabonds in countries where a reorganization of work along capitalist lines was underway. The ducking stool, the cart's tail, branding, the pillory, the cage, the thew, and the branks were all used for the torture of women. And this is they assert that there is a direct link in trying to clean up the riffraff and move toward a more capitalist, where everybody's worth something society, that is also very much in line with the witch trials, which everyone knows. But I mean, like, that's why I'm saying this is one of the most Marxist things I've ever read. They link all of this to a movement towards capitalism throughout England.
Yeah. I do know that, like, I don't know about any of that. I can't really say, but I do remember like that part where they had outlawed being a vagabond in England, and you were like branded, mm-hmm. and I think they like just cut your hand off just because you were poor. That's not fair.
No.
As a poor myself, I strongly disagree with this approach.
Let's go further. I can name those people. In the glossaries of cant or thieves' talk, we are given a veritable dramatis personae of the land rovers, all those who rejected wage labor. The Abraham men, palliards, clapperdudgeons, whipjacks, dummerers, files, dunnickers, cursiters, robbers' men, swaddlers, prigs, anglers, freighters, rufflers, bowdy baskets, autumn morts, walking morts, doxies, and dells.
Proud feet.
You gotta watch out for them bowdy baskets. They are a rough bunch.
Well, I don't know who's worse, the autumn morts or the walking morts.
Oh man, never get a walking mort and an autumn mort like in the same room. It's gonna be like a bloodbath. Like Hatfields and McCoys, yeah. That lot.
Yeah, and then assassins. But anyway.
Yeah, Elijah, I had that same section highlighted as well. That whole chapter was kind of interesting because it kind of goes into detail on how these people who were pretty much forced to work, they weren't like in name slaves, but these in some cases they were absolutely in name slaves, but these people, yes. the hewers of wood and drawers of water, built the infrastructure that this mm-hmm. new emerging economic system relied on to survive and thrive. And that was
interesting.
It was interesting.
It comes back into play later, I think in chapter 5 or 6 as well, when it's talking about shipping and maritime, when the English are really going at it, and that became the major form of the British economy was the Royal Navy. That the docks, the ships themselves, all of the labor that it took was indentured servitude. Usually, I think they would kidnap children That's where the term kidnap comes from. I did not know that. It was when children would be taken or spirited away. The people who would do that would actually be spirits. I'm not talking about that cool-ass anime film. I'm talking about people being taken and forced to work. But what struck me throughout reading that and everything else is how similar this is to right-to-work states in the southeast of the United States of America, where... I mean, if we can aside from the book for just a second, it's you live there and to a certain extent here as well, in a very much wage slavery, and it's propagated and supported by the United States government and the states' governments, especially there in the Southeast, where unions are beaten back and speak of union can get you fired without any sort of recourse for yourself. That's heartbreaking to me.
Yeah.
That the similarities there are so easily dismissed, and this idea of America's a free country. Well, your rights in America are extremely limited when it comes to your rights to be paid a fair wage for a fair day's work. But again, I mean, I don't want the hounds coming after us for radicalism, but it's not a radical idea. This has been around since, I mean, Winstanley and Backhouse in the 1500s writing some of the most Marxist things I've ever read. That was one of the most fascinating aspects of this book to me, is how far back these ideas of man being more than what he's worth to his masters, how far back that actually reaches.
Yeah, and that's kind of one thing that I've kind of always said about socialism or Marxism. Like, you don't really have to have like a deep understanding of Marx to have the same ideas, and it's kind of common sense. Like, it's about like treating human beings as human beings, whereas capitalism treats human beings as a source for profit.
A commodity, yes. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think I see it in a different way, but I think we're saying the same thing. I think, I would like to live in an egalitarian society, and capitalism necessarily excludes egalitarianism from its, right out the gate, because capitalism, like, demands,
it demands
a hierarchy of people, and
it demands cheap labor, oftentimes as free as possible.
Yeah. And I was talking to our dear father the other day. I was like, Jeff Bezos, if it were legal, he would totally have slaves.
Oh, yeah.
It's not.
Well,
like,
I mean, that's kind of what Elijah is saying. He in everything but name, he does the conditions
absolutely
for workers in Amazon factories is among the worst.
Yeah.
And that's entirely the way the system is set up. When you get cost of living increases that are minute increments that do not keep up with the way inflation is set up to run, it's geared towards keeping the poor poorer, making the richer richer. Okay. And that's how it's always been. And that's how it will always be. And it's the Marx-Hegel dialectic.
Well.
It's the Marx-Hegel dialectic. You always have the revolution. I think it was Hegel it was Marx that said the proletariat can rise when they have nothing left to lose but their chains. And that is the exact state that America is in, and it will not get better until it gets so much worse.
Yeah.
People there for the suffering, the amount of suffering that goes on just trying to get by. You saw this in the federal government shutdown where, these are...
Hey, you still there, bud?
He's been silenced. They took him out.
Uh-oh. The CIA got him.
Well, they got Elijah. He's gone.
Lock the doors. We're next. We're probably already surrounded.
Okay. So the connection has been cut. I'm assuming the NSA is listening.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes. Can you hear Ansel?
Hey, what's up, man?
Yeah, I could hear him whisper as well.
Okay. So, what happened there is we just got silenced by the CIA. some real ass COINTELPRO.
Well, I mean, and this episode isn't even live. That's that's ballsy. I don't know where we got cut off, but just to finish what I was saying is that this is the definition, as I understand it, and I can be wrong, of the Marx-Engels dialectic, where the situations have to be so bad for bloody revolution, and it's never peaceful. It's always bloody. And then once socialism or a socio-communist movement brings things back to a level playing field, that is only viable until human greed runs the course through capitalism once again. It's always swinging back and forth.
Well, I mean, this is something, a podcast I listen to, like, I try not to miss an episode, is Economic Update with Richard Wolff. Fantastic podcast, great record. And he was talking on it recently about, like, he's a very big fan of, like, worker co-ops, I think he calls them.
Yeah.
And like he kind of said why in the most recent episode. He was saying like that's really the missing piece in both Soviet style communism and Scandinavian style socialism. Like in either case, the thing that's missing is you have like top down ownership of industry instead of like bottom up. Like that's, if you have a democratized workplace where you have like representatives, like, you know, factory representatives or whatever, who have really the control of like what is produced and how the profits are divided up. That's really the key to sort of maintaining these socialist, communist, anti-capitalist societies.
Right.
So I think that's
what you just described, though, is a pirate ship.
Yeah, I was just about to segue. Let's talk about some democratically controlled workplaces. The 17th century pirate vessel. And this is the reason why I picked this book. Like, this was the most interesting aspect of it to me, is, you know, all of us have felt the call to raise the black flag.
You wouldn't download a car.
You wouldn't download a Dutch sloop.
I would totally download a car, by the way. I don't know. I think y'all would, too.
I think we were on the record as saying, yes, we would download a car.
Yes.
I would download a Dutch sloop for damn sure.
Yeah.
That would be sweet.
So this is in Chapter 5 under it's about hydrarchy. And that's kind of what the whole chapter is about, is the governance on these sea vessels. And it starts out talking about how awful the sailors had it on the merchant and naval vessels. And I've actually got a highlighted bit here. Before I get into that too much, like one quick quote from this chapter, something that I never knew. We don't have to spend a lot of time on this, but it says, as soon as the Mayflower discharged the Pilgrims, it sailed for the West Indies with a cargo of people from Africa.
Yeah, I did not know that either.
Like they don't talk about that in the Thanksgiving programs.
We didn't land on Plymouth Rock. Plymouth Rock landed on us and then sold our asses to some sugar plantations.
Yeah.
I would just like to say, for the record, I get really uncomfortable when...
That was my Malcolm X impression. I was.
Yeah, I don't like... I just don't like it when people... When white people try to, like... talk like that. Like Iggy Azalea is another example. Like I turn red. Like it's frim shaming all over again.
Nah, I was going for realism, but okay.
Yeah, I mean you can do it. I'm just saying it makes me.
I'm comfortable
in my
skin.
Crawl. Yeah,
I'm comfortable in my skin.
Whatever.
All right, so moving forward, talking about like the conditions that sailors experience on merchant and naval vessels. It says here, the knowledgeable anonymous author of a pamphlet entitled Piracy Destroyed, which came out in 1700, made it clear that impressment, harsh discipline, poor provisions and health, long confinement aboard ship, and wage arrears had caused thousands of sailors to turn pirate. So, like, basically, A, these people were being impressed. Like, they were forced onto these ships to work. Then, like, the captains were brutal, treated them like shit. They poor provisions of health. They often didn't have enough food to eat. Long confinement aboard ship and wage arrears. Like, they weren't even actually paying these people. Like, mm-mm. They would go
one up to 3 years at a time,
right,
I think.
Right, like, hard, hard labor, and then having, yeah, of course these people are gonna, you know, mutiny and steal your ship and then live a life of ease and plenty. I've got contrast that with the life aboard pirate ships. All right, so it says here, shortly afterwards, the pirate ship was egalitarian in a hierarchical age as pirates divided their plunder equally, leveling the elaborate structure of pay ranks common to all other maritime employments. And it kind of just goes into how, who got how much of a share. By expropriating a merchant ship after a mutiny or a capture, pirates seized the means of maritime production and decided it to be the common property of those who did its work. Rather than working for wages using the tools and larger machine, the ship, owned by a merchant capitalist, pirates abolished the wage and commanded the ship as their own property, sharing equally in the risks of common adventure. And that is...
you are what you produce.
Yeah, that's pretty damn awesome. It goes into talking about how they would treat captains of ships that they would capture. Like, they would take accounts from the crew, and if, you know, depending on how big of a asshole the captain was, that's the sort of justice that they would
give
receive.
Give them a little of the old keel hauling.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no, there was something worse than keel hauling, where they would hang them from the bow by the feet.
Yeah, I remember
and then
that.
Through the gradual motion of the waves, their brains would gradually be bashed out of their heads. And
yeah. I think that was something that the Navy and the maritime ships practiced more often.
No, it said that that's what they did. Like, if you fell asleep during your watch.
On your third offense.
No, the third offense is like they tied you to the main mast and put, like, baskets of bullets on both arms.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And then the fourth offense was you were, you know, tied to the side of the ship until your brains were beat out.
But, boys, there you have it right there, the birth of socialism, the birth of the Marxist socialist idea of communism, even, comes from pirate ships.
No, it doesn't. I mean, because it said the Indian tribes, you know.
Well, yeah, okay.
So it can't.
Still, I mean.
But still, pirate ships are cool and good.
Yeah, I found that to be extremely fascinating. And there was also mentioned that they would take the account from the crew, and if it was a good captain, they would let him go, maybe, with a little money. And if they had captured a bad captain that the crew admitted, you know, this guy's a son of a bitch, they would just execute them. And, you
right.
know,
I had this image, like, when you were saying what happened to the captain, like, they had a they had a sword-fighting duel. And they were each allowed four sprites, either sword up, sword down, or sword forward. And it always ended with the loser dropping to his knees. Yeah.
And you get a piece of the treasure map.
Microprose.
Well, yeah, just a couple other things here about these pirate ships moving forward, soldiering on. It also goes into detail about how... like racially egalitarian they were. Like, tons of escaped slaves, African slaves, and free men would take up with these sailors, because, I mean, it was either that or, like,
mm-hmm.
I mean, what else are you going to do if you're an escaped slave, really? Like, every you are, like, less than human to the powers that be, so...
Yeah. And you've just been boarded by people who are obviously obviously better fed than you are.
Right.
And reek of some good rum.
I mean, I think it's really easy to romanticize, like, being a pirate, but yeah, surely it sucked, you know?
Well, no, it was dangerous, and it was still hard labor.
Yeah.
But it was better than the sailors' experience on the merchant and military vessels of the time.
I can't remember where in the book, but it mentions that the stereotypical peg leg and hook hand and one eye was that's based in fact, that happened a lot. But you know, also the one eye was for other reasons. You usually had a good eye under that eye patch.
Yeah.
You know that, right?
Yeah, to different, like when you're above decks and below decks, you're like to keep your eyes from to be adjusted to one eye adjusted to dark, one eye adjusted to
really. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Huh. Yeah.
I've got one final note here. And this is in chapter 6, which is titled "The Outcasts of Nations." Not about the hip hop duo, matter of fact, but other outcasts. And this is just like another thing that I read, and I was like, wow, I have never heard that before, and like it's never talked about, so I wanted to bring it up. Saint Patrick's Day, this is in 1741, was a day for remembering that Saint Patrick had abolished slavery in Ireland. Did y'all know that that was what
Saint I did not.
Like, yeah, I thought he like chased all the snakes out. With
yeah,
the
like that's what I'd heard. That's always been told is like he got the snakes. I guess the snakes are the slave owners, but that was kind of interesting. I had never heard that before. But yeah, that's the last note I got. Like I said, I didn't get to the end of this book. It wasn't a fun read. There was a lot of interesting stuff in it. But it did kind of like circle around itself quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. It was work.
Yeah, and maybe not the best book I've read, but I learned a lot, of interesting stuff, and there was some stuff where there was just like leftist porn, just like revolutionary pornography. It raised my revolutionary spirit, if you know what I mean.
But I mean, it was good. I mean, it's good stuff. It's just something I'm gonna have to digest over a longer period than 2 weeks.
Right.
I don't think this lends itself to 2 weeks.
Yeah, because I mean, it's a textbook basically. I mean, it's pretty much this week's book club we're gonna read. You know.
Well,
Thomas's Calculus, 5th edition.
We said we were going to do all the books. Yeah, I mean, we got to get to the textbook sooner or later.
Before we run out of time, which I think we already have, I have a ton of notes.
Yeah.
And I want to backpedal to chapter 4 or 3. I think it's 4. There's this gentleman named Winstanley, and a little bit of background, we had a group in England known as the Levellers. The Levellers are sort of a leftist socialist, you know, we want to get rid of the fences, we want to go back to common farming grounds and get rid of this ownership society. He was very prolific in his writings. One of the shorter things he wrote, I want to share, he wrote, "Money must not any longer be the great God that hedges in some and hedges out others." And I found that to be very stirring, the idea of money and capital in early 1600s being spoken about that way by someone who, you know, had money. He was a businessman and lost it all. He then moved toward a planetary consciousness of class, saying once that English Christians are in a lower and worser condition than the heathens. He lamented, "Surely the life of the heathen shall rise up in judgment against you from the greatest to the least." His declaration of April 30th, 1649, on behalf of the common people was addressed to the powers of England and to all the powers of the world. Deliverance from oppression would rise among the poor common people and spring up to all nations and all the commons, and waste ground in England and in the whole world shall be taken in by the people in righteousness. Amen. Can I get a hallelujah?
Hell yeah.
Hallelujah. All right. That was good stuff. There was also a man named Lockyer who was executed, and the Levellers had this song, this chant, and I'm going to share that with you now. Talk about Kiss or AC/DC. These are some quality lyrics right here. This is, "Their self-will is their law. Stand up now, stand up now. Their self-will is their law. Stand up now. Since tyranny came in, they count it now no sin to make a jail a gin, to starve poor men therein. Stand up now, stand up now. The gentry are all around. Stand up now, stand up now. The gentry are all around. Stand up now. The gentry are all around. On each side they are found. This wisdom so profound to cheat us out of our ground. Stand up now, stand up now.
Well, I actually can kind of hear that as a Kiss song.
See,
like
I was thinking that's AC/DC.
Mm-hmm. Stand up now, stand up now.
No, it's got no, but if you've got the harmony vocals, it's the stand up now.
Yeah.
Stand up now.
And like the rhymes are so like, I'm sorry, Ansel just did the Kiss tongue at me and it, like I. Like I think I'm done. Like I just think I'm done for the rest of that. Like
you didn't know I could do the Kiss tongue, did you?
Now you know.
Stand up now, lick it up. Stand up now.
They do have an album called "Lick It Up," by the way.
I know. I know.
Well, let's.
The seamen were too far and widespread.
Yeah. No. We're definitely. Yeah. We're definitely encouragers of the widespread interchange of seamen. and all right, so let's rein this in. All right, so let's give this some ratings. Wrap it up.
I want to go first.
Okay.
I've got a rating. You ready for this?
Yeah, hit it.
All right, I'm gonna give the Many-Headed Hydra stories of the dark seas, capitalism, and Beast and Hercules. I don't remember the name of the book. This is the Many-Headed Hydra. I'm going to give the book that we read a pirate hook and a cutlass overlaid to make like a hammer and sickle.
Oh, I see what you did.
Yeah, it's the most Marxist thing I've read since Marx. And yeah. U.S.S.R.
that's great.
Yeah, that's pretty good. yeah, that's a good rating. I like it. Ansel, what you got?
I don't know. I was trying to think of something that would put you to sleep. I don't know. Pan's flute, Hypnos, the god of sleep. One of those like music box carousels, a mobile, something, I don't know. Yeah, let's go with the mobile.
So yeah, that's it. Just a mobile. Yeah,
pretty much. Just put me to sleep every time. It was interesting content. I regret that I don't have a mind for the humanities. I wish I did. I just don't.
I can't believe, Ansel, you're not like raving about chapter 3. It was all about Black Francis.
See, I didn't get that far. That's why. And anyway, like Black Francis. Yeah, I don't know. I do love me some Pixies for sure.
That's a good rating, Ansel. The mobile is a good rating. My rating for this book is my very own personal Many-Headed Hydra. My five cats, because like. Throughout this book, like the mini-headed Hydra, kind of represents not only like the proletarian, but classically it represents like chaos and like the chaotic revolutionary fervor among the proletariat and the subjugated classes. I am very pro Many-Headed Hydra, and I want to. Show off my own personal Many-Headed Hydra, which I love dearly, almost as much as I probably love him more than the Many-Headed Hydra presented in this book, but only slightly. But that would be my ever-growing supply of feline friends.
And what are their names?
Okay, so their names, I'll go oldest to youngest. Fox is the oldest. He's named after Special Agent Fox Mulder. Then we've got Dex, who is named after Dexter Jetster, Obi-Wan's...
Obi-Wan!
Good diner-owning friend. Hello, Dex. I didn't read that basically because I wanted to be able to come home from work every day and be like, hello, Dex. And she's a sweetheart. And then we get the three siblings, the littlest ones. We've got Gary Laser Eyes, named after one of Bubbles' cats from Trailer Park Boys. But it's Gary with an I because it is a female cat. We also have Gritty, who is an orange cat named after the wonderful mascot for the Philadelphia Flyers. And then you have Sabo, which is short for Sabo Tabby, which was a mascot of the IWW, the Wobblies, the International Workers of the World.
Ooh.
A little black cat. You've probably seen the black cat insignia.
Yeah, that's a good tie into the book.
Yep.
Nice.
Dylan peed on Sabo the other day, he told me. So
yeah, no, I left the door open to urinate into the toilet, and the cat jumped up on the rim of the bowl and was real interested and just stuck his head right in the stream. And like didn't immediately move it back. Like I had to relocate the stream.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to kink shame my cat if that's what Sabo's into.
That's a show of respect. That means that you're now top cat. But so congratulations on that.
Yeah.
You get to call the shots for the clouder, the whole clouder,
the crowder clouder,
the whole crowder clouder.
I tell you what, though, like one of these days you're going to be like reading a book for a book club, the podcast, and all your cats are just going to try to pee on your head to get that title back. So, yeah, heavy is the head that wears the crown, buddy.
Yep. also, shout out to Kirby, who is an adjunct member of the Crowder Clouder.
Yeah.
Kirby didn't get along with Fox, so we had to keep them separated. But yeah, that's my rating. I mean, I can talk about my cats for another hour. That'll be the Patreon only bonus content.
That's the Patreon exclusive, yeah.
So before we record that, let me pass this conch on over to Ansel.
Okay, I have the conch now. I still hadn't decided on anything. I want some kind of light reading because I got a busy couple of weeks coming up. So I've narrowed it down to either Alice's Adventures in Wonderland or The Hobbit by J.R.R. Tolkien. Which
I vote Hobbit.
Hobbit.
I vote
what
Hobbit.
Do you vote, Dylan?
I vote Hobbit.
I'm fine with either. Yeah. Can I just watch the Hobbit movies?
Yeah, sure.
There are mood letters here.
Wait, like
see?
The live action or the cartoon?
No, the Peter Jackson.
I think. I
oh no! Oh God!
Barrel Rider.
Why would you do that to yourself?
I think. I mean, I'm sure. Let's do that. And I'm sure the topic of cartoon movie, book,
live action.
They'll all come up. And
yeah.
Let's do it to it. Let's read The Hobbit.
Woohoo!
By J.R.R.
Yes.
Tolkien. I haven't read it since I read it once when I was weeing. And as a little kid.
It's been a few years for me, but I have read it since.
I read it like it was during spring break when I was like 13 or 14. So, yeah.
I think I read it the fifth time, maybe 4 or 5 years ago.
So we should have plenty to talk about.
Dude, I could do a Hobbit episode now.
I couldn't. I need to read it.
Okay.
Well, let's do that. Let's do that over the next 2 weeks. Let's read, watch, enjoy The Hobbit.
That's
in
a wonderful
myriad forms.
A wonderful idea.
And
I don't even have to read. That's awesome.
And we can reconvene here in 2 weeks. And
2 weeks.
Talk about it.
Yeah. Sounds good, guys.
Sweet.
Well,
in the meantime, you can hit us up on our Reddit, r/bookclubcast. You can find us on the worldwide Twitterwebs by typing in bookclubcast.com into your browser of choice. You can also send us fan mail or hate mail at bookclubcast, that's all one word, bookclubcast@gmail.com.
Yeah, send us a letter telling us how capitalism is good.
Yeah, do that. We'll discuss that
but,
in the
but,
Hobbit
but
episode.
No, seriously, I would like to have some fan feedback via the email account. Yeah, and if it's good, we'll read it on air and call us out if we have a bad mm-hmm. take.
It's bound to happen eventually.
Like
I don't think it's happened yet, but
I mean, Ansel kind of mentioned that earlier. We are not like experts.
We have no business doing this,
right? So correct us if we need correcting. We're open to criticism, and yeah, we'd love to hear from you. Thank you for listening.
Yeah,
it really does mean a lot. Well, all right, let's sign off there. Again, thank you for joining us. We'll catch you in 2 weeks' time with our Clubbing of the Hobbit by J.R.R. Tolkien.
What does J.R.R. stand for, Elijah?
That's John Ronald Rule.
Well, yeah, that sounds like fun. We'll see you then. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Mother, Mother Ocean, I have heard you call. Wanted to sail upon your waters since I was 3 feet tall. You've seen it all. You've seen it all. Watched the men who rowed you switch from sails to steam, and in your belly you hold the treasures few have ever seen. Most of them dream, most of them dream. Yes, I am a pirate, 200 years too late. The cannons don't thunder, there's nothing to plunder. I'm an over 40 victim of fate, arriving too late, arriving too late.